good morning, Pathway. Let's go to the Lord in prayer before we get started this morning. Father, we just come before you, and again, we just thank you to be able to be gathered together. We thank you to be able to get into your word, just to grow deeper in love with you, just to see what you have for our lives, Lord. And I pray this morning that you will speak to us. Allow us to know you. Allow us to just fall more in love with you, Lord, more in love with who you are, more in love with your word, and even with each other, Lord. I just pray that you just continue just to transform us. And that's my prayer every week, Lord, every day, that as a church family, you will just draw us closer to you and transform us more into your image. And we pray this morning that's exactly what your word does. We praise you and we love you in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. Well, if you're at home right now, I would like to invite you to turn with me to Paul's letter to the Colossian church. Paul's letter to the Colossian church. And we're going to be hanging out, we're going to be hanging out in chapter 3 this morning. Chapter 3. And here in chapter 3, we started last week, and Paul gave us a few commandments to start off with. In verses 1 through 4, he says, "Since now that we belong to Jesus, now that he lives within us, we no longer are part of the world system. We're separate. We're different. Our hearts and minds should be dedicated to knowing and serving him and him alone. Because when Jesus died, we were right there dying with him. Our old nature was crucified. It was put to death with him on the cross. And our life, Paul has told us, that is our life is now hidden in the Lord Jesus Christ. So that when the God the Father looks to the Son, he sees us. And when he looks at us, he sees the Son. You see, by his death, burial, and resurrection, you and I were set free from the bonds of sin and death. You and I were empowered with the Holy Spirit, and we have been given everything we need to live a Christ-exalting, Christ-honoring life. This is the wonderful truth of the Christian life. We are no longer held captive by our sin. Praise God. We are no longer held captive by who we used to be. You see, our old nature, it's been put to death. It's done. It no longer controls. But as the saying goes, old habits sometimes die hard, don't they? You see, knowing who we are in Christ is one thing, but living out this reality of who we are in Christ, it could be frustrating. It could be difficult. You see, though we're new creations with the Spirit of God living within us, we still live in an unredeemed body of flesh. We still have carnal desires that run through us and try to dictate our thoughts and our actions. You see, the remaining sin that lives within us creates a constant tension. There's a constant battle that dwells within us, a battle that every Christian is called to fight. This is the heart of Paul's message that he's going to give us this morning. He says, you've already been given everything you need to live a life pleasing to God. You've been given everything you need to live a life of victory in Christ. So live it out. Make it happen. Live your life for him. Look what he tells us right here in verses 5 through 11. 5 through 11 here in chapter 3. He says, put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you: sexual immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry. On the account of these things, the wrath of God is coming. In these you too once walked, when you were living in them, but now you must put them all away: anger, wrath, malice, slander, and obscene talk from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have put off the old self with its practices. Now, as we look at this verse, I want you to go back and look at verse 5. And you're going to notice the word therefore. And the word therefore is very important because he's referring us back to what he has already told us in verses 1 through 4. He says, now that your life is hidden in Christ, and one day soon, this will all be over. One day soon, he told us in verse 4, that we will be in heaven, whether we die and we are in heaven, or the Lord returns and we are in heaven with him in glory. But either way, when we go home, this battle will be over. Praise God. But in the meantime, you and I, we have some work to do. We have our work cut out for us. Now, Paul uses some graphic language right here to stress the urgency of what is required of the Christian. Look at verse 5 again. He says, put to death, therefore, what is earthly within you. In other words, since you have been given a new nature in Christ, don't let your old nature that has been put to death control you any longer, because it no longer has control over you. Take decisive action and kill the remaining sin that is in your life. Discard it. Get rid of it. Literally, put it to death. Now, the Puritans had a name for this. They called it the mortification of sin, or the killing of sin. As a matter of fact, John Owen famously said this. He said, be killing sin, or it will be killing you. And that's exactly what sin does. You know that? At first, it may look enticing. It may be enjoyable for a season. But its effects are damaging and they're costly. And the longer we dwell in it, the longer we partake in it, we become numb to what it is actually doing to us. Let me try to illustrate this a little bit. When I was in the Navy a few years back, I had a friend and he loved hiking. He loved going out and just hanging out in the wilderness. And one day he was out on a hike and he sat down to take a breather, just take a rest. And when he sat down, he felt a pinch on his upper thigh. He didn't know what it was. And he just said, okay, just maybe just some kind of a little bug bite, not a big deal. So he continued on his hike. But as he continued on, the throbbing started to set in. And then he looked down and it started to become red around this area where he had been bitten. Well, soon his leg began to swell. And as his leg started to swell, this little tiny bite all of a sudden turned into the size of a quarter over a few days. And then after a few more days, this quarter-sized bite now emerged through the swelling, and the decay of the tissue now was the size of a softball. You see, he was bitten with the bite of a brown recluse. And the venom from this brown recluse bite literally had spread and destroyed the tissue from the source all the way out. It destroyed everything that it touched. And for this type of spider bite, you see, the only way that you get it to stop spreading is you have to take a scalpel and you have to cut it out. You have to cut out the venom. You have to cut out the decaying tissue. You got to get rid of it, or it will continue to spread. It'll take over the entire leg until literally you might have to have an amputation. You see, this is a great illustration of what sin does in our lives. Beloved, we have to purge it and cut it out before it does serious damage to who we are. Paul's telling us right here, put to death all that is earthly within you, because this is no longer who you are. You are no longer who you used to be. Get rid of it. Mortify all the things that once controlled you and dominated your mind, dominated who you are. Put it to death. Kill it. Paul tells us something very similar in Romans chapter 6. Look what he tells us right here in Romans 6. He says, so you also must consider yourselves what? Dead. So you must also consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body to make you obey its passions. Do not present your members to sin as instruments for unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and your members to God as instruments for righteousness. Now, you might be looking at these writings from Paul and thinking, man, that's kind of extreme, isn't it? Man, put to death, kill, mortify, these are strong words. But what we don't seem to grasp is Jesus' words were a lot stronger than Paul's. Jesus' stance against sin was pretty absolute. Look what Jesus tells us right here on his Sermon on the Mount. He gave us this command. He says, if your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. For it is better that you lose one of your members than that your whole body be thrown where? Into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off, throw it away. For it is better that you lose one of your members than that your whole body go into Gehenna, into hell. Beloved, is sin something we should take seriously? Think about this. If the Lord Jesus Christ and the Apostle Paul saw sin as this serious of an issue, how much more should we? Understand, we are to hate it. We are to hate it. We are commanded to purge it. Now, Paul's telling us here that this must be dealt with in our lives. But we must also remember something very important. Very important. How are we saved? How are we saved? Are we saved by purging all these things out of our lives? Are we saved by living a righteous and a holy life? Absolutely not. We are saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, to God's glory alone. Not of works, as it says in Ephesians 2:8. Not of works, so no man can boast. It is solely the work of God that we have been saved. But here's the question. How do I know that I've truly been saved? How do you know that you have truly been saved? It's because you've been given a new nature if you belong to Christ. You've been given a new nature that desires to serve Him. You've been given a new nature that desires to please Him and to walk with Him. Understand, if you've been born of God, He is going to slowly transform you into His image. He's going to slowly change you over a period of time where your life starts to look like His life. Where you love what God loves and you begin to hate what God hates. Listen, this is the mark of a true Christian. He may sin, and we all sin, but when he does sin, he hates that sin as God hates that sin. It grieves him because he knows it grieves God, who is his Father. Paul makes this abundantly clear in Romans 6. Look what he says in Romans 6. He says, what shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. Literally, God forbid. How can we who died to sin live in it any longer? You see, a person who has been born of God will desire to love and please who? The one who saved them. They desire to please Christ. They desire to walk with Him because a Christian has died to the world. He has died to his own ways, and now he lives for the one who gave his life for him. Beloved, who do you live for? Who do you live for? Do you live for yourself? Do you live for this world? Or do you live daily for Christ? Do you live for Him? Because a Christian lives for Jesus Christ. So the first thing Paul tells us here is we need to put our sin to death. But here in verse 5, he goes on to tell us what we are to mortify. He tells us what we are to kill. Look at verse 5. He says, put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you. Sexual immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, covetousness, which is idolatry. Now, what do all of these sins have in common that he gives us right here in this list? They're all sins of the heart. They all have their roots in lust and greed. And the two sins that dominate the world system are just that, lust and greed. So the first sin that Paul tells us to steer clear of right here is what? Sexual immorality. And immorality comes from the Greek porneia. Porneia, and it's actually where we get our word for pornography. It's the root of that word. And it could simply be defined as any sexual activity that is committed outside the bonds of a heterosexual marriage. And in Paul's day, sexual immorality was rampant. It was everywhere. It was just a common way of life. It's how they lived. Matter of fact, if you went to the city of Ephesus, you had the Shrine of Diana. And in the Shrine of Diana, they had prostitutes who worked this because Diana was the god of fertility. And people would travel from miles around to come in and to fornicate and to just partake in gross immoralities at this temple and in this city. But you got to understand, it wasn't just all in Ephesus. All the cities back then were grossly immoral. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, Paul addresses this within the Corinthian church. And he gives the church a sharp rebuke for turning a blind eye to those who live licentious lifestyles. But the fact of the matter is, as bad as it was back then, I think that we have come a long way past that in our day. I think we've taken immorality to a whole new level. Living in open sin is not just accepted in our culture, but in our day, it's widely accepted and celebrated. Sex outside of a marriage is not only prevalent in our culture, but it's made its way into the church and made its home right there. I've known many couples who are not married but live together, yet they attend church weekly. Many of them attend church weekly, yet are not convicted of their sin, not convicted of what they are doing and how it grieves God. We've seen the open celebration of homosexuality to transgenderism being labeled as a societal class. Sins that were once considered taboo are now the cultural mainstream. All you had to do is look around. And yet, many churches who know this is wrong, many churches who know the Word of God, they remain silent. Silent on these issues. As a matter of fact, just recently, Sarah and I were walking downtown Fort Wayne. And as we were walking around, we saw a few churches who were openly hanging gay pride flags in their churches. How far we have fallen. How far we have come. Our tolerance for immorality has led and morphed into the acceptance of other horrific sins. As a matter of fact, this time last year, there was 150 so-called, and I say that, I use this term lightly, so-called pastors who came together and signed a letter demanding that abortion be provided, that it be available for anybody who desires it. They celebrated it. Folks, these were not lawmakers. These are not town officials. These are churches doing these things. Listen, abortion is not just accepted, it's now openly praised as a wonderful thing in many of our denominations. Instead of the church transforming the culture, the world has come in and made the church its home. And for those of us who hold the Bible as the infallible, inerrant Word of God, how are we viewed by society, by these sorts of people? Extremists, bigots, hate mongers. But we need to understand that this shouldn't surprise us. The prophet Isaiah saw this coming in his day. Look what he wrote. He goes, "Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Woe to those who are wise in their own eyes and shrewd in their own sight." Beloved, is this not true in our own day? Where are we? Where are we? All that is anti-God is celebrated as good, and everything that is good and of God is depicted as evil or bigoted. And the unfortunate reality is, this is only the beginning. The Bible tells us that things are going to get much, much worse. But there's good news. There is good news. Though society is decaying at a rapid rate, we serve a God who is immutable. We serve a God who does not change. The writer of Hebrews tells us that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And in Isaiah chapter 40, he tells us this: the grass withers and the flowers fade. Oh yeah, all these things happen. We see all this change. But the word of our God, the word of the Lord stands forever. It doesn't change. The gospel does not change. The demands of the gospel do not change. You see, the problem isn't with God, the Bible, or the church. The problem lies with inept pastors who are too afraid or ashamed to preach the truth. Pastors who will abandon their commission to faithfully proclaim the full counsel of the Word of God as the sole authority for the church and have instead turned to entertaining, to trying to make people happy, to keep their congregations full. Beloved, this is why the church has lost its voice. This is why our kids are leaving the church in droves. Because they see no difference between the church and the world. They're synonymous. They're the same. They see no difference between a Christian and an unbeliever. Beloved, we are called to be different. We are called to be holy, literally set apart for God. "Be holy as I am holy," declares the Lord. This is not optional. This is who God calls us and commands us to be. It's an imperative of Scripture. Listen to what Paul tells us in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. He says, "For this is the will of God, your sanctification, that you become more like Jesus Christ, that you abstain from sexual immorality, that each one of you know how to control his own body in holiness and honor." Beloved, we are commanded to flee sexual immorality at all cost. We are called to mortify it, put it to death. We got to kill it. Now, what are the next three sins that Paul gives us right here in verse 5? Impurity, passions, evil desires. These are all immoral, lustful sins, not of the external. Now he's bringing us back in where? To the heart. He's bringing us to the heart. And there's a good reason for this. What did Jesus tell us on the Sermon on the Mount? He said, "If you look at a man or a woman with lustful intent, you've already committed adultery," where? Right there, in your heart. You've committed adultery by the intent. Listen, before you can put to death the outward acts of the flesh, you have to deal with the internal reality of what's going on. You must kill sin at its core, at the heart. You see, all of these sins have one thing in common. They all come out of greed. They all come from a covetous heart. And covetousness is not merely desire to possess more than one has. Covetousness is wanting more than we ought to have, especially if it belongs to somebody else. Covetousness is really just another form of lust or evil desire. It's greed. But even more than that, covetousness, what does Paul say it is? It's idolatry. It's setting ourselves up in the place where God was meant to be. We're saying that my ways, what I want, is better than what God wants for me. And by that, we worship those things. We set them up above God. Now, Paul gives us another list of five sins that I want you to see here. Five sins that we need to deal with in our lives. But these aren't personal sins so much as they are social sins. Look at verse 8. But now you must put them all away. Anger, wrath, malice, slander, and obscene talk from your mouth. Do not lie to one another. He says, put these away. In other words, take them off. And this is in the Greek, this is literally what it's saying. Take off those old, stained, marred clothes and put on the new clothing which you have been given in the Lord. Take off. Take all that off. Remove it. Put it to death. Now, anger refers to that burning hatred for other people. It's a burning hatred. Wrath in this context refers to those outbursts of passion and rage that we have, that ungodly rage that we have for others. Malice refers to ill will towards one's neighbor. And slander refers to railing or defaming another's character. And abusive speech refers to those destructive words that we use to tear people down. Paul says, people who are captured by sin are people who are intently conflicted. They are liars who are filled with rage, and that rage pours over into the lives of their speech. Paul says to these Colossians, and he's telling us this morning, don't live like this. Don't live like this, because this is not who you are anymore. You're a new creation in Christ. That may be what you were in the past, but that is not who you are now. So be who you are and put to death your old ways. Get rid of them. Cast them off. You see, Paul's point is simply this. There is absolutely no room in a Christian's life for any of these sins because Jesus Christ died for them. They have been put to death on the cross. And you were put to death on the cross with Him. Anger, wrath, malice, those who slander and lie to others. Beloved, there is absolutely no room in the church for any of this type of behavior. It is unacceptable. Completely unacceptable. Listen, we are called to hate what God hates and to throw away all of our filthy rags that we once wore. Cast them off. We are to mortify them. Amen? Mortify them. Now, Paul gives us two good reasons why we should put them to death, and they are definitely good reasons. Look what he tells us in verse 6. He says, on the account of these things, on the account of these sins which I have just told you, the wrath of God is coming. He says, if you need a little extra motivation for living a godly life, just remember who this God is. Remember that it is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Where he says, vengeance is mine, I will repay, declares the Lord. He is a consuming fire. We must never lose sight of that. I like how Arthur Pink puts this in his commentary. He says, God's wrath is the eternal detestation of all unrighteousness. It is the displeasure and indignation of divine equity against evil. It is the holiness of God stirred against sin. It's a big deal. Paul put it this way in Romans 1. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against how much ungodliness? Understand, God is an equal opportunity employer against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. I think that sometimes we fail to truly understand how much God detests and hates sin. I think we forget that it is caustic. It's cancerous. I think there's many who don't believe that God will ever judge the nations. But what they fail to recognize is He's already demonstrated His wrath in the past. What did He do in the antediluvian period? He flooded the entire earth. Why? Because their sin was so great. He judged cities such as Sodom because of their wickedness and their immoralities. And Scripture is replete with warnings that God's anger is being stored up for a future judgment against the nations. Friends, it's coming again. His judgment is coming. Look what we learn in Revelation chapter 20. Then I saw a great white throne and Him who was seated on it. From His presence, earth and sky fled away, and no place was found for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne. And the books were opened. Then another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged by what was written in the books according to what they had done. And the sea gave up the dead that were in it. Death and Hades gave up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one of them according to what they had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. And if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. Folks, you need to understand, there are only two options for eternity. There's only two. Either you have trusted and surrendered your life to Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Either you have surrendered your life to Him and said, Lord, I no longer live for me. I trust in what You have done for me. I trust in Your sacrifice. I confess my sins to You. I trust in Your righteousness to get me to heaven. Either you trust in Christ or you trust in yourself. Either you're on your way to heaven through Christ's righteousness or you're on your way to hell. Either you're still in your sins and the wrath of God is waiting to be executed against you at the white throne, or you are written in the Lamb's book of life. You have door A and you have door B. There is no door C. He is the way, the truth, and the life, and the only way to the Father. Two doors. You have to make that choice. You have to decide. Do I trust in myself or do I trust in Jesus Christ? And I pray you make the right answer. And I plead with you this morning to come to Him and to surrender to Him. Trust your life to Him. Look at verse 7. In these things, you too once walked when you were living in them. You see, He's giving us a second reason right here. A second reason for killing our sin. His point is this. If you're in Christ, you are no longer who you used to be. You're no longer a slave to sin. It no longer has any power over you. You used to be a slave, but you are now free. I like what it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 6 when Paul writes on this, because it's such a powerful statement. Look what he says. He says, or do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. neither the sexually immoral, nor the idolaters, nor the adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor the drunkards, nor the revilers, nor the swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. Ah, but here's the good news. And such were, past tense, and such were some of you, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of God. And were such some of you. Beloved, we're not that anymore. We're new creations. These sins that once enslaved you and me, they've been defeated at that cross. They're gone. They no longer have a hold on us. Amen? Is that not wonderful news? They no longer have to control us. So we come to the how of this morning. How do we mortify the remaining sin that dwells within us? That's the ultimate question, isn't it? How do we get rid of it? How do we have victory over this? How do we clean our hearts that are filled with ungodly passions? All these desires of our flesh and focus our minds on Christ? Well, the answer is right there in that question. You see, the first thing we must do is we have to look to the cross. We have to look to the cross. We must set our minds that are on things above, as He has just told us in verses 1 and 2. Set your mind on things above, not on things of this world, where Christ is. Set your mind where your heart is, where your spirit currently resides in Jesus Christ. Listen, this is what Paul's been telling us through this entire letter. Remember who you are now. Remember the reality of what has taken place in your life. The battle is won. Remember how you died with Him and how you were raised with Him in the newness of life. And set your heart on the fact that your life is now hidden in Jesus Christ. Remember that you're seated with Him in the heavenlies. You see, our motivation for living a Christ-centered life is based on the fact that He who began a good work in us, what is He going to do? Oh, He's going to complete it. He's going to finish it. He's going to take us from this process of sanctification, which is a daily grind, into the ultimate place of glorification, where we are perfected and finally in an eternal place of glory with Christ. No more sin. No more suffering. No more battling sin. No more of this. But secondly, if we want to have victory over the sin in our lives, we must kill the motives. We must kill the motives, not just the behaviors. Listen, behavior modification, it could be a good thing. But if that's simply all you're doing is modifying your behaviors, it may work for a while, but it's not going to last. It's just a temporary fix. It's a band-aid. You see, for lasting change to take place in our lives, we must uncover and deal with the motives and the desires that cause that behavior. So let me ask you this question this morning. When is the last time you went before the Lord in a quiet time, a quiet place, and just prayed the words of David of Psalm 139? Search me, O God, and know my heart. Search me. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any grievous way in me. Lord, show me who I am. Lord, show me my blind spots so I can see them and then start purging them out of my life. That's what Jesus tells us in Matthew 15. He says, but what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart. And this defiles a person, for out of the heart comes evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, and slander. To deal with sin, we have to go to its source, the heart. We have to deal with it where it starts. To kill sin, we have to attack it there. But thirdly, we must heed the words of Paul in Romans 13. And these are important words. And if you don't have these memorized, I encourage you to have this passage memorized. We must put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh. That's an imperative. It's a command. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh. Romans 13, 14. Now, I want you to notice what it says right here, because it's important. He doesn't say, grab your boots by the bootstraps and just make this happen. Kill sin by yourself. Go out there and do it. Do it now. Is that what he tells us right here in this passage? No. He says, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ. In other words, it's only through Christ's power that you're going to have victory in your life. It's only by trusting in Him and allowing Him to dwell richly in you and having your eyes fixed firmly on Him that you are going to be able to overcome certain sins that entangle you. I need to borrow an illustration from Brian Hedges. He says it's kind of like parachuting. You can't parachute unless you jump out of the plane. But you have faith in the parachute that it's going to work. We have faith in God that He is going to deliver us from our sins. You got to believe it. You got to trust and know that He who began a good work is going to complete it. You have to believe that. You have to have faith that He is going to transform you and mold you and grow you. But we also have to do our part. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ, and after you have trusted in Him and you're filling yourself with His Word and you're growing in the grace and knowledge of who He is, then make no provision for the flesh. Make no provision. Listen, if you have a drinking problem, the last place you should probably be hanging out is a bar or a club. The same goes for sin of impurity and lust. If you struggle in this area, maybe it's time to put some controls in place to remove some of this temptation in your life. Maybe the Lord's convicting you that you just need to completely get rid of your cable TV service. And just get it out of your life. If you're a channel surfing and you're looking for things to entertain your lustful desires, maybe He's saying it's time for it to go. We are to heed how he speaks to us. Maybe you need to get an accountability partner, which I highly encourage, where you have somebody in your life who prays for you and holds you accountable and asks how you're doing on a weekly basis and talks to you and helps you through these trying times. Whatever it may be, the bottom line is this. What are you allowing to fill your heart? What are you allowing to come in and take residence within you? Are there some books, magazines, movies, websites that you know you just need to scuttle, you need to cast out of your life because they do nothing but bring you down? If that's the case, what are you waiting for? Mortify the sin. The same goes for societal sins. If you're someone who is easily brought down by those who gossip and slander others, if this is true of you, then stay away from them. Don't associate with people who bring you down and cause you to sin. And yes, these types of people exist even in church, or in church on Sunday mornings. Stay away from them if that's what you need to do to keep from falling into their trap. Don't allow them to bring you down. Stay clear. Same thing goes for those who speak filthy language. If you struggle with having a tongue that likes to curse and swear, don't associate with people who that's all that they do. Because as the saying goes, it's easier to pull somebody down than it ever is to bring them up. Who are you associating with? If you battle with swearing, if you battle with this, Think about your surroundings. Think about who you're around. You see, Paul's calling us in this passage right here, and this is a hard one, I know, but he's calling us to do a personal inventory of our lives. He's calling us to do a reality check of what's really going on, who we're really serving. What's holding you back from maturing in your faith? What's stopping you from growing closer in your walk with the Lord? And I challenge you this morning, do some soul searching. What is stopping you from growing and falling more in love with Christ? Do you hate your sin? Does it grieve you? When you sin, does it hurt you as it hurts God? Understand, we've been given His power to live lives that are pleasing to Him. But we must mortify these sins that so easily ensnare us. We need to slay them regardless of the blood and pain. We need to put them to death, knowing that's what God has called us to do. We need to take seriously Paul's counsel given to us here in this chapter. Because evil thoughts produce sinful behavior, where a mind set on the Spirit produces what? Righteous behavior. What are you allowing to control you? Let's close with these words from Paul in Philippians 4:8. He says, "Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things." Put off the old. Next time we get together, well, after Mother's Day, but the next time we jump in here to Colossians 3, we will look at what we are to put on, which is Christ. Until then, let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this morning to be able just to hear your word, Lord. And sometimes it's a soothing word, and sometimes it cuts, Lord. And your word is sharper than any two-edged sword, and it cuts both the joints and marrow, soul and spirit. It divides, and it shows us the thoughts and intentions of our heart. And I pray this morning, Lord, that we can do an inventory of our lives. Are we living lives that are sold out for you? Or are we just kind of just going through the motions every day, thinking that's enough? Are we mortifying the sins that's in our life? Are we asking you to show us the sin that is damaging us, that is eating at us, that is not causing, that is creating a barrier so we cannot grow in who you are? Lord, show us and then transform us through your power. It's not by our power. It's all by you, Holy Spirit. We thank you so much for your love. We thank you so much for your conviction. And we thank you so much for your power to change us. And we pray that this morning. Change us, O God. Change us. Grow us in your image. Allow us to fall more in love with you. We love you and praise you. And it's in the mighty, wonderful, omnipotent, awesome name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Are you
Let's close with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Well, God bless Pathway. We have some very, very good news, actually on a couple fronts. The first good news is next week, we are actually going to be going and picking up the children's playground set that we were hoping to get. Everything has went through, and we have received all of the equipment that's at Meadows Elementary School. So we're going to be bringing that back over here and hopefully setting it up over a period of time. So very good news on that front. And even better news is on Mother's Day next week, we are going to be meeting again and coming back together as a church family. And I am super excited for this. I've missed you all very much. And I look forward to just being able to worship together. For those of you who are kind of hesitant about coming, we are going to ensure that there are several, just make sure that we have controls in place. Social distancing will be completely, it's going to be also put into place as well. So I want you to be able to come and just know that we are taking your health and your well-being very seriously. But it'll also be a great time to just be able to come and just hang out with each other, to get in the Word together, and just something that's just very much missed and needed, for sure. But until next week, I hope you have a great time in the Lord this week. Just continue just to grow in the grace and knowledge of who He is, get in the Word, go to Him in prayer, and we will see you. Not on video, but we will see you here at the church next Sunday. God bless.
The following sermon was presented to you by Pathway Christian of Harlan. If you're in any way encouraged by this message or would like to know more, we would love to hear from you. Please visit our website at pathwaychristianharlan.com, or you can reach out by calling our office at 260-234-8571, or by mail at 12732 Spencerville Road, Harlan, Indiana, 46743. Until next time here at Pathway, God bless.